Please bear with me, I'm gonna mess us around a little bit this morning. So just bear with me. Acts 1:8. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. The Bible says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. Now, this was written in Acts of the Apostles. For those of you who have read ink-lettered Bible, this was the word of Jesus Christ. This was the commission. This was the assignment he gave unto the disciples before he ascended. He asked them to wait on him until when the Holy Spirit will come upon them. When the Spirit come upon them, then they will receive the power to do what? To be a soul winner. And in the day of Pentecost, Acts 2, the Holy Spirit manifested. They were empowered. In Acts, the Bible said, Peter brought how many souls to the kingdom? 3,000 souls, because the power has come upon them. The question is, in the new church, what are we doing with the anointing? What are we doing with the anointing? How many souls are we bringing? Tell your neighbor this year, you must be a soul winner. Say it, I say you mean it, I permit you. Tell another neighbor this year, you must be a soul winner. It is an assignment from your God. Amen. So if someone asks you, why should you go on this assignment, write it down. Because God has commanded us to do so. He has commanded us to do so. Write it down. It's the commandment from above. God has commanded us to do so. Secondly, write it down. It demonstrates our love for God. You're not writing? It demonstrates our love for God. John 14:15. If you love me, obey my commandments. If you love Christ, you obey his commandment. And his commandment, he said, if you love me, go ye into the world. In my name, disciple others. Tell them about me, not about you, but just tell them about me. If you love God, then go out there and be a soul winner. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the final words of Jesus while on earth said to his disciples, when the power come upon you, please go ahead and testify about me. And if you want to do it, you have to do it because you love him. He first loved you. Say, greater thing will you do. John 14:12. Greater things that I did while on earth with you, when the power come on you, you will do greater thing. This is an empowerment. Hallelujah. Thirdly, because all are lost. Because all are lost. Romans 3, verse 10 and verse 23. Verse 23, we quoted very well. Romans 3, verse 23. For all our sin are conscious of God's glory. But look at verse 10. Say, as it is written, there is no righteous. No, not one. There is no righteous. Not even one. All have sinned and come short of God's glory. And this is why Jesus Christ came. I started by saying, he did not just come to die for dying's sake. He did not just die to let you know that if I die, I have the power to revive and destroy. No, he died to save the lost, to redeem, to pay back the price for all our sin. For all our sin and cut short of God's glory. All, including you and I, including the lost in the world. They are lost. They don't know where they are. And they are waiting on you. Amen. They are waiting. The lost are waiting on you. Oh, no. Don't sleep on me, brother and sister. It is only the redeemed sinners. Are we together? It is only the redeemed sinners that can reach out to the lost and save them. If someone is giving you a testimony and you are excited with a testimony, and at the end of the testimony they say, oh, this is what I read in the book, it is not my own testimony, how will you feel? He has not appealed to them. They don't know how it feels. But if the person said, I have been a mother, but this is now my life. Where you are sitting or standing, you'll be wondering, do I hear him right? You were a mother right before? So what changed? What took place in your life? You want to know, and you want to be part of what took place in your life. It's only those that have been transformed, just like you and I. They can go out there and tell somebody, brother, I have been like you. Amen. If I stand here and I say, your pastor has smoked, you'll be wondering, pastor, no, you make it up. I have smoked, I have drunk. Amen. I have messed up many times. Fell, pick up, fell up, pick up. That is the beauty of it. So when I start to share the gospel, I'm not just telling you about what I read, but what I have been through, what I have lived. He whom I know, Colossians 1:4 says, in him I don't know about you, in him I have redemption. Even the forgiveness of sin. You don't need to tell me that my sins are forgiven. My sins have been forgiven. Yeah. I am a new creature. I'm a new creature. Because I've been down. I've been there. From the bottom rock or the rock bottom, he picked me up. Hallelujah. From nowhere. When everything gave up on me. When everything gave up on me, he looked down. He said, Saul, I died for you. Now you're not telling me to be quiet. No, that is your imagination. Impossible. I will not be quiet on Jesus Christ. In him I have redemption, even the forgiveness of my sin. In him I have my life. He is my life. He is my life. I am crucified with him, but I live. It is no more I that live. Jesus Christ of Nazareth, he who died by death could not hold ransom. He resurrected after the third day. He lives in me. I can't be quiet on him. I cannot be quiet. When everything closed on me, when everything gave up, when everybody gave up on me, when everybody thought nothing good could come out of my Israel, he said, wait and see. Wait and see. I haven't finished the war with him. You are condemning him. He is a vessel of honor. I am a vessel of honor. I don't care what my circumstances is. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning. I don't know what your circumstances is, like your background. Listen, God has just started with you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Father. Let me put on this one. We have to save the lost. We have to save the lost. Thank you, Jesus. Please don't give up on your neighbors. Don't give up on your children. Don't give up on your husband or your dreams or your wives. Don't give up. You are in their life for such a moment like this. You are in their lives because of such moment, so that you can just share the grace of God with them. Support them. Church, don't give up on your pastor. Support your pastor in prayer. Don't give up. Don't give up on your dreams. Pray concerning your dreams, your hopes, your future, your aspiration. Pray, but don't give up. Quitters are not winners. Winners can never be. Don't give up. Don't give up. Write it down, the fourth one. Oh, I love this one. Open your Bible to the book of Romans 10:14-17. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Romans 10:14-17. And the word of God says, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent, as it is written? How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel, for Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Brother and sister, I said it before, if you have not heard, if they have not heard, they will not change. The person that you are so much mad, you are about to push them down and forget about them, if they know what you know, if they know what you know, they will change. They will have a change of perception about life, because the information is not sinking, it's not relating with them. That's why they are still fighting against the truth. Bible says, ye, we all will know the truth, and the truth will set us free. John 8:32 is the verse 36. Say, whoever the Son of Man set free is free indeed. Because you have known the truth, that is why you see things different. But because they have not known the truth, they are yet so uncover the truth. They are yet to detect the truth. They are yet to believe the truth. So everything you throw at them is negative because they don't know the truth. They are trapped in their opinion and self-orientation, believing what they believe is all good. But because you are the other eyes of the world, who has been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now you look at him, you say, brother, I wish you know where I'm coming from. And brother, they say, brother, I wish you are not messed up with your religious belief. See the contrast? You can give up. This is the sanity of it. Apostle Paul was known to be Saul. Saul took a permission and he was on his way to persecute the church, to arrest believers and kill them. The Bible says when he went to Damascus with his entourage, because he had his own disciples, even while he was in the world, they were free with him. And boom, light struck from heaven. Light struck him down. He fell. He heard a voice. He was hearing the voice. His disciples were not hearing. And God said, why are you persecuting me? So that person said, but Lord, who are you that I'm persecuting? The conversation ended by saying, for this same gospel that you are persecuting, you will suffer for it. He got up from there. Bible says he became blind. They lay hand on him. He received the Holy Spirit. He suffered for the gospel. Now, this is where I'm going. Because of how much persecution that came through him, wherever he goes about the gospel, people's hearts were connected to him. At first, they were like, but is it not you that was persecuting them? Say, yes. That is why I've been saying to you, I was like you. In ignorance, I thought I was serving God. Just as you are serving your own God out of ignorance. But when I know the truth, God, I don't want to be quiet about his grace. So he writes to the church in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8-9. He said, by grace I saved not by the work of my hand, not by my intellectual ability, or by grace have I. Not of work. So he did more work, glorious work, than even the apostles that were with Christ in his earthly ministration. Why? Because he has been in the other side. The reason why you and I should go is because there is no better person for God to use. Oh no. There is no better person to my world to be used except me. I thought you were going to say that to yourself. People are waiting on you at your place of work, in your neighborhood, in your community, in this our local church. People are waiting on you to give them their testimony. They're waiting on you. This is our world. What we are seeing is our world. Don't be quiet. Apostle Paul did greater exploits because of his background. In Isaiah 9, in Isaiah 6, Isaiah heard the voice of God, and the Bible said, "Here I am, O Lord, send me." What are you waiting for? Don't wait until you will be consecrated and say, "Now we have ordained you as a pastor," before you say, "I want to go and be a witness." No! Don't be quiet. Don't be quiet on Christ. The grace of God is sufficient for you. Don't be quiet. Every given opportunity, reach out to someone. Inside the bus, inside the train, reach out to someone. God bless you, brother. God bless you. Look, are you a Christian? Conversation will start from there. Reach out unto them. Don't be quiet on the grace of God. Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah, somebody. God is good. Open 2 Peter 3:9. Give you few compelling reasons why we should share our testimony and go out then and make disciples. The fifth one, the book of Acts. No, 2 Peter 3:9. It is the desire of God to save all. It is the desire of God to save all. 2 Peter 3:9 said, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." It is the desires, the will, the plans of God to save all. And if God desires to save all, he needs you as an instrument. Mind you, God is a spirit who is not going to come out into this our world and forcefully enforce his desire on us. He will not do that. But he's looking for someone, a willful heart, who will allow his spirit to come into their life so that he can carry out his assignment. This is our assignment. It is our assignment. It's the assignment of the new church. Go into the world and make known Christ to all. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It is an assignment. Go to the world. Blessed are the feet of those who bring the good news. Your feet are blessed. Your endeavors are blessed. Because you are out there for the kingdom of God. It's about the kingdom. Lastly, in 2 Corinthians 1:3-5. 2 Corinthians 1:3-5. I know many of you are Christians, born of both parents, Christian parents. Very good. But some of us, we are who we are by the grace of God.
Amen.
We are just who we are by the grace of God.
Amen.
2 Corinthians 1, verse 3 to 5. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort those who are in any trouble with the comfort which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in also, our consolation also abounds through Christ. You see the verse somewhere in the Bible say, you and I have been comforted that we might do what? Comfort order. You have been saved that you can go out of your way, your comfort zone, and look out for the losses of the house of Israel so they can be saved as well. You have been blessed not just for you to become a billionaire, but so that you can provide for those who are in need. You are saved to save others. You are saved to save others. And someone have to share their faith. Hello? Someone have to share their faith. I don't know how you become a believer or a Christian, but I believe you were not just sitting down and the angel just appeared and said, today, you know, you are a Christian. I believe that was not the case. It's not all of us that had the story of Apostle Paul. No, not all of us. He was one of a kind because he had an assignment. He had a mission. He was commissioned for that purpose and for that testimony. But the question is, somebody might have one way or the other witnessed to you.
Yes, sir.
Either at your kitchen table, your dad or your mom might have shared their faith with you and you become a born-again Christian. It might be in your school or in your dorm or wherever. It might be anywhere, or perhaps at your workplace or on the train or wherever. But someone must have led you to this faith in Christ. Somebody. And if at least 70-80% of us can agree that that is the case, so don't you think it is right for us to agree that some people are out there waiting for our testimony? So then why are we not doing it? Or maybe your good Sunday school teacher has led you to become a Christian. Or maybe it's your pastor. Thank God. But someone at one point in time has led you to Christ and you are not a Christian. How many people are you now leading to Christ? I was looking at a telegraph, United Kingdom telegraph of 2013 that talked about Bill Gates. No, Bill Gates. So now they watch the richest man. He has this foundation with his wife, Melinda. And I was looking at it, and he said that money is irrelevant to him because he has to use money to do the things of God. He's someone that I know that he doesn't talk much about, you know, about religion and about the things of God. So when I saw the heading, I was curious what prompted him. And that led to how he has been disbursing his money. He enjoyed grace of God. He has championed, among all other things, the eradication of polio in Africa. You don't get it?
Yes,
to himself, he doesn't need anything more from God except the life that he's enjoying. He has gotten it. He has stepped down from being the head of chairman of Microsoft, he's still there, yeah, but he now concentrates on the foundation. Among all other things, education, health, eradication of poverty. Disbursing a lot of billions. And I look at him, Warren Buffett, another billionaire, last year gave Bill Gates Foundation $2.8 billion. Altogether from 2006 up to now, Warren Buffett has given Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation $24 billion. He has given them. He is a billionaire. He has a foundation named after his wife, his first wife who died. He's given that one billions too. But much of everything that Warren Buffett owns or earns, he has given them to the Gates Foundation because he believes in what they are doing. They cannot be quiet on the grace of God. Now you will be worried, but they have more than enough. That's why they are given. And that is what I want to talk to you about. You don't need to be a millionaire before you can do something to impact your world. You don't need any platform. Hello? You don't need a church platform before you can share the gospel. You're not getting this one. After all, I'm not a pastor. Why should I share? You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be a millionaire to give out unto others. It is out of belief system. If you are stingy now, when you become millionaire, you will be stingy. Yeah, it's a belief system. If all word that comes to your mind is, let me hoard, just me, the world is me, I will do all I can, I come to America to become rich. It's a bad philosophy. It's a bad belief system. You got to change it. Any clothes, I said it last year when we ran through the eradication of poverty, any clothes in your wardrobe that you have not used for 6 months, there would never be an occasion for you to use it again. Get it out and give it to somebody else. Your worn-out shoes will be celebrity shoe for somebody. Give it out. Of course, you can imagine with all these billions that I'm talking about, Warren Buffett and Bill Gates, you can imagine what he could do with it. You can imagine. If Bill Gates worth about $68 billion US dollar, he can buy more than 5-6 nations in Africa. Buy them. Buy the citizen and buy he can buy them and he will control them. He's not thinking of doing that. He's not thinking of owning America. He's not thinking of controlling America. He's giving out. He have no family members in Africa that are dying. African and Pakistan and India. These are the mostly infested area with polio. In Pakistan, in doing the research, they were refusing his workers to bring the medication down there because they thought they're coming, America are coming, you know, to come and monitor them. He still negotiating with them. He believes if the workers are allowed, that it's about give them 5-10 years, they will eradicate polio. At their own detriment, they refuse free medication to eradicate polio. What is he getting out of it? Nothing. And here you are. You will be asking, why should I go and preach? What will I get from it? Coming to church all the time. What will I get out of it? You don't need to get anything out of it. Somebody paid the price for your existence. Oh no. Somebody paid the price for your life. And does that say something to you? And what are you doing for others who are out there? What are you doing? What are you doing for others that are out there? They are waiting on your testimony. They are waiting on you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the book of 2 Kings, even as I begin to round up, 2 Kings, if you may, please, you can open your Bible there. It's a story that we're all familiar with, 2 Kings, chapter 7. And I will round up with this one. When you consider your physical ability or perhaps inability, you take your mind away from the grace of God. Yes. If you were considering so much on the limitation that you are experiencing, or the limitation you have, which are just temporal limitations, you miss the larger picture. Yes. I don't have pastor. I can't be there, pastor. Everything, you cannot. So what can you? This story is a story of four lepers. You all know, you all heard about it. There was a famine in the land, and by the nation of their birth, they were lepers. I believe no one ever prayed to be born as a disabled.
Yes, sir.
How? Nobody knows. And by the Levitical order, they were outcasts. They were not meant to be a part of the society. So they have a colony for them outside the community. And they keep them there. So they live at the mercy of others. Now, the indigents enjoyed everything in common. But they lived at the mercy of the indigents. So in the land there was no rain. Famine broke out. Shortage of food. People became carnivorous animals. They began to feed on their flesh. And this one, I believe, this one were dying. They were dying. And finally, they said to themselves, how long is it going to take to go to the camp of the Assyrians? They don't know, but they're going to put their life at risk. They put their life at risk. They're not welcome because they're outcast. But now there is no food, no rain, nothing in Israel. Israel will not take us. Let's go to the enemy. If the enemy can be merciful unto us, to God be the glory. If not, let them kill us. But we're not just going to be quiet. And they began their journey. Mind you, no toes. And as God will have it, every step they took in the camp of the Assyrians, they were hearing thunderous voices, like it was thundering. Boo, boo. And they said to themselves, the Israelites are coming to kill them. And there was no Israelites. Israelites were dying. Four lepers were coming. Their stampede was producing a thunderous noise to the enemy. And when it became so vicious, they ran out. Oh, Assyria, run for your life. Israelites are coming. They all ran away, leaving behind prepared food that are still on the gas cooker. And so they go to the gate. There was no gate, man. They have no hands to knock. I believe they threw their serving and the door opened. Door opened, they saw food on the street. tinkers, gold and silver, diamond. They were like, oh, this is a trap. This is a trap. They knew we were coming, but the trap was. So they waited. Now they are hungry. They left the first house. They went into. They saw some food stuff. They ate. Now they regained their strength. They were still thinking, is it a trap? That they began to go from houses to houses. And they realized that God has chased them away. God, I don't know what you are going through. I don't know what you are being through. I come this morning to tell you, God is setting you up for divine visitation. Through what you are being through what you are going through, God is setting you up for divine visitation. They never knew. They began to walk and begin to move. And the God that is saw all the place litter, filter with all this abundance of goods. And they go from house to house and house to house. They were packing gold and diamond and silver. They were so happy and rejoicing. And they said to themselves at verse 9, this is the day of good tidings, but it is not good for us to be quiet. It is not good to be quiet. If you really see the grace of God, brother and sister, if you are really enjoying the grace of God, you cannot be quiet. It is too hard for you to hold to yourself. It is too big for you to keep alone. It is too precious that you need to speak about it. Don't be quiet about the grace of God. Don't be quiet. Be quiet. The Bible said, they drop everything after they have eaten and they have drank. Gain strength. Now, in such a day like this, when the king of Israel himself, the king of kings, who rule over the affairs of Israel, is on the throne now, we are not going to be quiet. They abandoned everything and they ran away to the palace. Here we come. We have been an outcast, but today we have a good news. I don't know where they have said you can't go into. I don't know who say you are not worthy to come into them. But when you come with the good, the Bible says, blessed are the feet of those who bring the good news. Where they say you cannot enter, you will enter. Because the Bible said the gift of a man will make room for him and make him to stand before great men. Your gift in the Lord, we open doors for you. Lepers, outcasts, they head tied to the palace and they say, oh ye king, how many years? This is the day of the Lord. Let's go and possess our possession. I know many of us, if we were to be in the position of those lepers, we would have said to ourselves, let's take all that we can take and go to our own camp. After all, we are an outcast. We don't need to share with them. That is the selfish in us. That is the Adamic nation in us. But Christ came to redeem us from the curse of law. He died for us. Interesting. When you become a Christian, that selfishness is being dealt away. If you are still sitting on the grace of God, I can't share this with my brother. I can't share this with my sister. You are yet to be a Christian. If you think deeply, it's not you going to your work that gives you money. It is not that two weeks paycheck that is sustaining you. It is the grace of God. Apostle Paul put it, see, I'm not worthy to be called an apostle. I was the least among them. See, but thank God for his grace. Oh, thank God for his grace. He foreknew me, he called me. And he said, and I thank God because that grace upon me has not been even because I do more than the so-called apostle. I want you to stand on our feet. Jesus, stand on your feet. You are condemning people in your mind. Sometimes you're thinking, why should God extend this grace and mercy to them? Do you deserve the mercy? No. By his grace, we are all been saved. By his grace, we are all been saved. I want you to pray unto God even as I round up. And your prayer will be focused on the grace to be able to share the gospel, to be able to share yourself, your grace, the grace of God upon you with humanity. In this year, you will not be quiet, that the Lord will open doors for you. God will open doors for you. God will take you to where he wanted you to go. Not where you wanted to go, not where you desire to go, but what God himself has ordained for you, let God take you there. Let God take you there. What God wants you to do, let God enhance you to do it, no matter how demeaned, no matter how bad, no matter how humiliated it is, but Lord, not my will, but your will in 2017. Not my will, not my desire, but your desire, enhance me, my spiritual ability, enhance me, open my eyes of understanding, Lord. I want to do your will. I don't know how to do it, but I surrender unto you, King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I surrender my house, or my family, my wife, my children, the members of this ministry, this neighborhood, nation. I surrender all unto you. Your grace is all we pray for in such a day like this. For your word said we can do all things through Christ that strengthens us. If you use just even King the lepers for your own glory, or say you can use us, we can be used by you. We desire to be used by you. We lift up our voices unto you this morning. We ask over you, pour your spirit on us. More of you is all we need. Take our eyes away from all our situation. For your word say we should cast our body and our anxiety, our worriedness unto you, for you will sustain us. According to Psalm 55 verse 22, we cast all our bodies unto you. We take our eyes away from the world. We look up unto you. According to Hebrews 12 2, the author and the finisher of our faith, the one that was, that is, that forever remains, you let that die sleep or slumber. We cast all unto you. Lead us in the journey of 2017. Lead us, Lord, to the right place, the right people, the right organization. Lead us, Lord, lead us. Lead us to the right people in 2017. Lord, lead us. Lead us. Lead us in our decision making. Lord, lead us. Lead us, Lord. We enthrone you over our lives, individually and collectively. Lead us, Lord, lead us. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit of God. We bless you, we worship you. Glory be unto your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Put your hands together for Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Our God.